backdrop. Run it back. Not on the right to this music. But we're gonna do it, go ahead and do the sharing that we need to do. We're gonna get this shit right, we're gonna get it together today. We're gonna talk about balance politics or politics, whatever you wanna call it, baby. We're gonna talk about it today.
From the northern side of the sea. Whoa, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be. All wasted on the ocean to have on our seas. Fish full of mercury. Oh, oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be. Radiation underground in the sky. Animals and birds who live nearby. Oh, mercy, mercy, mercy. All things and what they do.
Come on in, y'all. Come on in. Hey, Nikki. That's my daughter. I love you, girl.
We're gonna be more humble while we being your friend. This is the den when we jump out. Guess what? We ain't jumping out. Well, I was gonna say y'all jump in, but
can't be us.
We have a number for you to call in on next week. This week, we're gonna delve into some deep Dallas politics.
Y'all gonna listen. No.
Let me share this shit because Facebook stay tripping on me. Lily's gonna entertain y'all for a few minutes while I do this.
Y'all want a magic trick?
Sure. Take your thumb out.
Okay. You ready?
My thumb.
Watch me pop it out. Watch my
God. Oh my God.
It's magic. Yes, tune in, everyone. We are talking about Dallas politics. On a little bit of that big PD word.
Porterhouse and biscuits?
No. The little brutality that the boys in blue love to do.
I might have to be quiet because they might come after me if I speak. I got some true issues with the boys, and I do mean the boys in blue. But I will shout out to the Dallas Black Police Association. I don't know how bad they got reprimanded after they stood up against police brutality, but they did. And I think that that's big because nobody stood by them and the Maine Police Association, which there should only be one. Why is the
Why
police association? No, there's actually three, the Hispanic one too. Mm-hmm. Latino or something, you know, whatever that they call it. I'm not really into them.
We know why.
Even the police are segregated. Like,
we think joining these groups will protect us. No, because when you take off that uniform, you're still a nigger.
When you got that uniform on,
you're still a nigger.
Speaking of Fair Miller, who do we believe? Jay-Z, that's a legend. And he's older legend than Kanye. He said, you still nigga no matter what. Kanye say, it's a choice. I say, what is it, nigga?
He just did that for attention.
We got my fam in the background say he just did it for attention, and I'm inclined to agree. I'm also the one gonna tell you, look, she said I talked
to you. No, I'm gonna say we have a live audience. You know, when the show say recording in front of a live audience, that's what we do. So you hear clapping and woo, we got a whole audience.
My Facebook tripping, man. The man is against us, man.
Just her.
We going live from DeMarco. We're going live from YouTube from here on out. My mind is escaping me. My mind's telling me no.
I don't fuck with
but this wine, this wine telling me yes. Dallas, we finna talk about it. We gonna soak up. Oh, Kelly is not
a part of the show. We don't fuck with him.
Hey, and we if y'all see them two chairs in the back, so we got some special guests for you as we continue on. You know, because
did we take a minute?
We might. Pimp Smith up.
Good
shut up.
I was trying to let you guys get in, and we just did this whole show, but Rashida
effed it up.
But
so
you like
we're
me
coming back to anyway. We was founded the city of Dallas in 1841 by a known racist and slave trader, and also advocate of the Confederacy, John Neely Bryan, whose own great 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 grandson Eric, no C but a K, denounced him in 2016, I believe. The article wasn't date stamped, but I could tell by the information in it, it had to be recent for us. It discussed some of the recent events. When I upload this video to YouTube, I will add all the links. And I found so many links about Dallas, I think I'm going to go ahead and do a monthly newsletter and just send something out if you guys think that's a cool idea. Go ahead and put it in the comments. Is that a cool idea? Would you like to see topics and links and stuff about the topics that we speak about? D Magazine wrote a revealing expose in 2017 titled When Dallas Was the Most Racist City in America, citing the 13,000 white male Ku Klux Klan members in the 1920s that rose up. It was the third rising of the Klan, and the biggest rising was here in Dallas. Mm-hmm. Me and Lily were talking about how thick Dallas is with anti
not Dallas
togetherness.
What?
Girl, Dallas. You said they had done killed the president. Don't get on here and try to act like you don't know about Dallas.
They killed the president?
They had done killed the president. Got a big old X on the ground. Where
no. That was an accident. Not an accident, but you know, they locked the dude up. It's all the same. It's not, you know, because that wasn't a part of the plan. It wasn't, you know, on purpose. It's not a reason that it happened here. Not a reason that out of all the presidents, he was the only one that was uncovered like that and just blown up in front of everybody like it was nothing. And
so was it post-racial Dallas?
Let's see. Oh, my bad. No, Dallas, it's just the people here. Sometimes we just invite bad people, you know, and we just killers and stuff. And that's why we're not on the news, and that's why our police department, the records are so clean and so good because we haven't killed people like the many and many people that we killed. Or my bad. No, we blew him up. We blowed him up. With no ID, no nothing. We just
Michael
know
X.
that he was the one who shot the polices, even though people that was there saw multiple people. But oh yeah, that was good. Don't hide shit.
They called him Michael X on purpose. The man's name was Michael Xavier. They try to associate him with a certain group with that X.
So you just gonna throw that on him? Like, and he's had the perfect name for all of this. It's great, you know.
And they blew him up. The whole building was blew up around him. But he wasn't blew up. He just had a little blood on him.
No. It was cool. We didn't really get to see because it was blocked off for forever, but I don't think they had to rebuild the school or nothing or fix nothing.
So let's revisit early Dallas. So we've been talking about renaming some local streets. Emmy Crenshaw would replace Marilla Street if we got our way. And we were discussing if we were to get rid of Confederate monuments, Dallas is a Confederate fucking monument. John Neely Bryan.
Like you was gonna give him a name?
I do. Y'all know I mess up somebody's name in a minute. So John Neely Bryan.
Bryan.
She wants y'all to get
the right person.
She wants y'all to get the good information. Y'all know
I'm not related to John.
So anyway, he in 1850 purchased a black boy for a year for $125 and some clothes. This is the founder of Dallas we're speaking about. In 1910, Alan Brooks was executed by hanging downtown Dallas. I think it was either Elm and Eckerd or Elm and Main, something like that. I think it was Eckerd, Main, or something. Right downtown. You go through that area all the time. They used to have what were called whipping parties at the Trinity River.
Oh, so when you that's why I think so.
They think the dope dealers and gangsters been killing people, throwing folks down there, but they ain't the first ones. They didn't start that shit.
Trinity for years, they've been putting niggas in the trench. They'll go swimming over there.
Devil's Punch Bowl. And that ain't even in Dallas. That's in Mississippi, I believe. Tennessee.
We hear about it everywhere else. Why don't you hear about that place that's like here? Why? We do shit like this.
Honestly, I think that promise that they made at the end of the Civil War is what they're trying to do now. South shall rise again.
Even on the forefront.
Our president is third generation claim.
Who president?
Them people's 45th president.
You said ours. Now I'm single right now. I'm trying to find myself. I took a break.
Some more fun facts, child. I'm going to tell you about your city now. Alexander Johnson was kidnapped from the Adolphus Hotel and beaten badly and tattooed with acid on his forehead with the letters KKK. Return back. He wasn't killed, but he was returned back as a symbol to the rest of the people.
Oh, we don't know that the KKK is still here because they burned.
Oh, baby, them bloodlines and generations. When you wonder why you can't get ahead, when you wonder why you elect that black person and they get right in office and start acting like a Republican when they was supposed to be a Democrat, and you.
But when we used to
reevaluate your life,
but now we Democrats. But they used to help us over here, but now they help us over.
Hey, Daryl. Hey, Ben. Hey, Amy. Hey, baby. Hey, tune in. We talking about old dirty ass, stinking ass Dallas.
But she got one time to tell y'all, hey, in the middle of me talking, and it's gonna be just me doing this show. It's gonna be me. It's gonna be. I'm gonna sit in the middle like this, and I'm gonna talk to y'all.
You want me?
I'm testing out. Yep. Tell your mama. Then it's gonna be it.
That's my mama, y'all. Tonight, but anyway.
My daughter.
Who was your son?
I forgot. No, I'm just playing. I did, but I mean, my whole thing is Dallas got a lot going on. I was more prepared today for us to speak just about police brutality.
We talking about all that good
shit. We don't talk about all that. all of it.
What y'all sipping on? Get y'all snack. She said we won't talk about all that. I wouldn't cut nobody off.
No, I'm just missing you. That's how it is.
Okay. I ain't scared of Lee Lee. Ain't nobody worried about Lee Lee, y'all.
I'm the biggest one out of everybody.
Tallest, biggest the whole person six, seven.
Everybody's afraid of me.
I'm the corrupt militant midget I'll ever met.
So disrespectful. This is a topic at hand because you guys came for a topic. No, but seriously, it's a lot of stuff that's going on here. Think about it. The police were killed. Protests somewhat ceased. All the people that was here rowdy in 2015, where they at? It's a lot of silencing. It's a lot of subliminal silencing. If you look around, you see all the, it's still blue ribbons up. Why are those blue ribbons up? Why are they still continuing to be like that when so many black people here have been killed by police? But yet when it comes to the police killings, we show it everywhere. And it's to hush people, to scare them. When you put people in places for hours at a time and you lose them and try to make them be trying to reach and make them a part of the problem and stuff like that, you scare people. Send them to jail, you do all types of stuff, but shit they didn't even do. So then they get out and now they scared. Now they don't want to speak up. Now they don't want to talk about what's going on now. They don't even want to talk about what happened to them when they was behind bars and all of that stuff. So it's a whole lot of different secrets that go on here. It's a whole lot of different stuff. And people are scared to talk about it because it's like the Illuminati. We don't know what's going to happen. Somebody will have to sacrifice somebody, or you're going to be the sacrifice, or what is it going to be? What is it really going to be to set the city off to where there actually is some change? When do we stop being silent? When do we stop being scared? When do we say, okay, when do we accept the fact that we don't have to do more work than just going out into the middle of the street? When we gonna realize there's so much more that goes into this? When are we gonna look like Rashida researched so much on the city? How many of us actually look into the things that are happening around the city? It's a lot of shit that going on that we don't even pay attention to. Like I said about the blue ribbons, when the blue ribbons went up, people got real quiet. People got real nervous. A lot of Blue Lives Matter in people's front yards, a whole bunch of that stuff. But I remember a friend of ours had his Black Lives Matter sign in his window and got a brick blown through it in 2016. But y'all think we free. We mad at Kanye because he said slavery was a choice. It's the whole mindset. When we think about the fact that the Willie Lynch left. We think about the wickedness, though. We think about the fact that he said for 200 plus years, how many years you say? However many years he said, long ass time. It was going to be them, their kids was still going to be enslaved. He meant that. He said, get the biggest, strongest nigga you can find. Huh. Time to one end of this horse, the other end to this horse. Slap him. Split him in half in front of everybody. You got the kids, the grannies, the everybody in one. When you see that somebody can do you like that, you're in fear. You're scared. That warrior in you is gone. They took our native tongue. They put these cages around our mouths so when we started to speak in our native tongue, they could bring them to their knees. Our tongues get cut up. Our faces get messed up. They beat us and they instilled so much fear in us. To where when they started to give us back shit that should have, that was already ours. It's like me telling you, your hair in a ponytail. But me telling you, you can't wear your hair in a ponytail. And then me coming back and saying, nah, you can wear your hair in a ponytail. And you appreciative because I done told you can wear your hair in a ponytail. Now that's some shit you should have been able to do from the jump. Who the fuck told me that I had the right to tell you you couldn't do it? So since they got it into our head that we couldn't do things, and then they eased us into being able to do little bitty things at a time, being able to sit at a counter and order some food, being able to vote, being able to do little things in their society. We had to fight and keep trying to get into their society, and then we got complacent. Now we excited because they didn't gave us some stuff. Like, we are good now. We don't have to even worry about nothing. They gave us housing and food stamps, and we is good.
I hate when people say that. Food stamps is reparation. They started that for white folk.
And who the motherfuckers be going to jail behind that shit?
By 40 years after they started that shit, niggas was allowed to join, finally.
Why do we need them, though? Because the families were separated. Why was the family separated? Let's see. It started way back when we were taking men, shipping them off, taking women, bringing them over here, or even in front of the man. The woman was raped, had to bear a child. Now this man got to see his wife being taken. It's a whole lot of stuff. First of all, we couldn't get married. We jumping brooms, getting married in silence and secrecy. And now that we have the right, to be able to do so, we don't want that shit for what? Why we need this? Why we need this? It's so much, man, and we are mentally enslaved. How many people do you know are in prison behind shit that is nothing? Did you see that they making a whole weed house? Anybody seen it? That they building a house out of cannabis that's supposed to break ground this year?
So they playing with
white, it's some white men.
My brother got 15 years because he defended himself in a case on I think 5 pounds of weed that's legal now. They finna make a weed house, apparently.
They making it this year.
I forgot we had some fruit.
I've been eating this fruit. Shit. But yeah, they made it to where it's gonna be legal. Well, it already, what was it passed? Like last year, I think it was, that they voted on it, but we still waiting for everything to finish for it to be legal here. But are they gonna let the people out this in jail for weed? When all the white boys getting famous on the fact that it's still a federal offense. So you can actually own a legal dispensary here, and if the federal government feel like they wanna come in and shut your shit down, they can shut your shit down, you can go to prison. Federal prison. Because they decide. It's a whole bunch of shit. And the thing about it here in Texas, to the good old boys, only reason they making weed legal now is because they know they can make some money from it. Anything that they know they can make some money off of, and anything that's good for you, first of all, it's gonna be legal. Alcohol is legal. Why? Because that shit fuck you up. You gonna go crazy. You gonna shoot some people, kill some people, do all types of stuff. They wanna blame it on the rap music, but what about this stuff that's altering our minds? Cigarettes, it say on the box, can cause cancer.
I used to lie on marijuana and say marijuana caused cancer.
But it said on the box. But it's places where people are smoking marijuana just so they can help their sickness. It's a whole lot of different stuff. Anything that's good for you, they take away from you. They charge you an arm and a leg for it. All that stuff that say organic is 9 times out of 10 not even organic. If you have one organic ingredient in it, they can call it organic. The FDA, obviously, is bull, man. But when you think about Texas and the fact that we were the last ones to be free, we out here celebrating Juneteenth like that shit cool. We need to be mad as hell every Juneteenth.
And June 14th is a big day for the Klan. Now, I wrote it down, but I don't have it in front of me right now. But y'all got to do some of y'all researching so it'll be valuable to you. They got a Juneteenth, too. June 14th. Mm-hmm. Should I get some old facts on the histories of the history of Dallas?
Yes, y'all. I ain't say. They always give us just barely enough to hush us up. Hell yeah. That's to make us feel good, feel like we've done some shit. Ooh, bam, we got a statue that's coming down. Ooh, we made it. So the people gonna fall off after that.
Anytime you need a payment, good time. Anytime you're lacking up for free.
I'm gonna say consumerism is one of the main issues. Yep. We fund they shit.
So y'all ride up and down the R.L. Thornton and all these streets. We trying to get one street renamed. I think we need to get whole Dallas renamed. This whole Dallas is a Confederate monument.
Yeah, something. I don't stand for the Texas pledge. Don't stand for the American pledge. Why? I mean, the pledge of allegiance. Whatever.
My mama was Muslim. Nigga. I've been a renegade since I was a kid.
My daughter don't stand for that shit. And people say, but you're in America. But when that was created, I wasn't in mine. The way that I was standing for a pledge for a country, they change that shit, include me in my people, include my people in that shit. Then I might stand for that shit.
But as a writer,
I would never stand for some shit that talked about my people that killed me, and they don't give a damn about me. For what? For what? For what? Remy say, wake them up, y'all. We trying. Little by little, we is trying.
Well, R.L. Thornton was a known, documented Klan member. And although the Dallas Morning News can be damning,
and damaging. Now, they stood up against the Klan in the 20s, as well as the Dallas Times Herald, which most of y'all young folks, y'all wasn't here when the Dallas Times Herald, but I remember the Times Herald. So, this state, this city is rooted in racism. I know I am from Oak Cliff. That's my hood. Put it in their face. Get it understood. This ain't what you. Hey. That's my hood. Yeah. I got crunk. Hey. So, I studied white flight out of Oak Cliff, and I found this interesting conversation on a blog that said, I mean, that shit touched me like this. I grew up on Alaska Street, right next to SOC, right down the street from SOC, South Oak Cliff High School, for those of you who aren't from Dallas who may be tuning in. So I found out that as soon as integration passed, the first street in Oak Cliff that sold all of their houses was Alaska Street. So this shit is so well done. We talk about the system, but we have no idea. That shit, that article, or that blog conversation, touched me. What my grandmother thought was her blessing was our officials, our dentists, our judges, our people that we respect or that have leverage on us. They was being funny. So I had some more because I know it was one thing I definitely wanted to say because our beginning government, okay, in the 1920s, which like I said before, is the third rising of the Klan.
Hey, Chalet, what's up, fam?
Hey, baby! Oh, that's how I got the Saturday! She look at man's life. We're all mothers and workers. Sade just started her own business and she got projects going on. We're praying for her and hoping that, you know, she come back to the show soon. She will be back, but she's taking a short break. Mm-hmm. But in 30 states, because of the third rising of the Klan, passed racist eugenics laws. 30 states. But it was our choice. Every founding member that's, I shouldn't say founding member. Government, anything, any Dallas government was started by Klan members. You tell me. Sorry. So they say she gonna be back. We gotta say welcome back. She really ain't gone because she in the thread. Hey, on location wherever she at. Hey,
yeah, we got the problem.
Go ahead. I ain't have no more facts. We're gonna really break into in the second hour. We're probably gonna go for 2 hours on this motherfucker because Dallas. Hell on wheels. As a matter of fact, y'all need to tell us, should we do a monthly newsletter? Because I found so many links and so many PDFs to document about how racist Dallas is. And I think you guys need to know because there are some reckless statements going around, similar to that of which Kanye so easily said from his slave post. You know?
Y'all not scared, y'all.
No, nah, they should be.
Everybody got to die at some point. Don't be scared.
We thought Facebook was the belly of the beast. Facebook ain't the belly of the goddamn beast, right?
Think about that.
Tommy Loren, Richard Spencer, the motherfucker that shot up Vegas. Who else? Ever known, they got some kind of ties. They got some kind of ties to Dallas, Texas.
Right. So we talk about conspiracy theories and stuff like that, right? I hate to be a conspiracy theorist, but first of all, Facebook, we using y'all, so don't delete that shit. But Look, I sound like a T.I. on the song. Okay, whatever.
We're going to get our website that we can go live from soon. It's coming. We're getting everything worked out. Go ahead.
But, yeah, that's a long thing, Shade. What was I going to say? Damn, I really had something to say about something. What you talking about?
I don't know what I was talking about. You gotta tell me what I was talking about. About the finishes. Why? No, I didn't warm up to y'all. What's in the glass? Her answer. Apple juice. What the fuck was I gonna say? Apple juice, and it's from red apples. Red apples make brown apple juice. The inside of that hole is brown.
What they had done?
Oh, they had the inside is red now, purple.
Damn, I had some real good to say. About conspiracy theory. Sorry, y'all. Sorry, y'all. Think about colors. How colors really affect us. Different things and shit. I'm not gonna say a whole lot about the whole what is it called? It's not called My Life Matter. What's the new movement called? It's called
they got a new movie.
Yeah, after the kids were shot, what is it called? The kids, the school shooting, the last.
I wish the girl don't tell me that.
What's the name of the damn thing?
Parkland. I don't know.
Come on, man. Somebody.
I don't know the movement. Everybody, Sade probably know.
Sade, what is called, fam? Hurry up.
It's something. What was in that glass, baby? That glass don't never end. You hear me? It refills itself. What the camera?
What is the damn thing called? It's called My Life Matters. This is called My Life Matters, I think something like that, right?
They are with, oh Lord have mercy. We already know they life matter.
Okay, so the whole My Life Matters movement or whatever. Like I'm not mad at it, and I think it's great. I know a lot of people is really happy because these kids is doing something, and you know, everybody's talking about the fact that boy was also in a couple of other mass shootings and all types of stuff, but think about colors. They color. Blue.
Color.
Just like the Blue Lives Matter.
What they the fuck is a blue light?
I don't know what a blue light is.
I think the cops.
No. What? No.
It okay, is. When we what, say black you know, lives matter, we know we talking about people with a certain pigment on their skin.
You know blue people? It's avatars. They the avatars. So avatars, they do matter. I like Avatar. That's my favorite movie. How about they love Avatar? They talking about the avatars. But no. Like the colors and stuff, they make you think about certain things. Everybody can stand behind it. When you put something with a black fist on it, people already look at it like, what is that?
They've done a good job of keeping us separated. Majority of white people, because folks, you know, I've had debates recently since the man, I'm not going to keep mentioning his name, said that reckless statement. People are saying that
I'm sorry.
It don't take me long to forget what the hell I was saying, so you can go ahead. It's gonna come back. It's not the wine. It's not.
No,
she.
We retarded. Everybody.
We don't eat fish.
I don't eat cheese. Well, we don't know what that is. It might be cheese.
Totally look, this ain't even go through these
but pink not, ones Kanye, from all. Let's be honest. Kanye is mentally ill, and somebody really needs to help Kanye, because I really think Kanye is a genius. I really, from the bottom of my heart, I think that Kanye is a genius, but I really think that Kanye. I think Kanye is really messed up, and I know a lot of geniuses that have Kool-Aid. Extremely high Kool-Aid. Look, damn, IQs. And you know, I really messed up, but I really think he a real life get out situation, like for real. Like,
and he was on the slave block when he said that bullshit.
Them Kardashians are not going to give him the help that he needs, and it is up to somebody that care for him to really help him. But people are too busy trying to disassociate themselves with him and mad at every statement that he makes. And then people like, you know, it's a publicity stunt, because every time before his album come out, he makes some crazy ass statement. But the nigga last few albums been sucky. I ain't even practice them. I heard like a song on them hoes and was like, I wish I would. I love old Kanye, and I think Kanye is really, really deep down inside the Kanye that's floating in the what is it called? The sunken place.
in a sunken place. It's somewhere in there screaming, help me get the fuck out. Somebody need to go over there with a mug and a damn spoon and just clink that bitch a couple of times so we can see him wake up for a little, or we can take a picture of him with a flash. Where the paparazzi at when he be doing shit like this? Let's just go and take a picture with a flash, get him to be him for a second. Don't take a bunch of pictures, just one, so that he can come back. We love you, Kanye. We never gonna let you go. We love you, man.
They ain't never gonna let you go. I ain't got the, I'm like Harriet Tubman.
She up here singing R. Kelly songs, but she won't get Kanye another chance.
Shit, R. Kelly been a pedophile and Harvard
1772.
Okay. That nigga said on BET when that shit first happened and said, how old is a teenager? And, I'm consulting with my pastor. That was his answer to was he a pedophile. So, I mean, anybody who's in the dark, and Sharonda, if you're watching, I love you, boo-boo. I know you. I know that's your boo, and you want to hold out hope for me. They trying to do a conspiracy again. They don't do conspiracy. They let them hoes go out there and do all that they going to do, and they take pictures and record video and keep receipts.
People that like issues.
Next thing you know, he going to be up there like Kanye. Being black was a choice. See, before you was born, it was a gene called Zodomite that you could have changed and you could have came out any color that you want. So being black was a choice.
Well, I chose this year. I did. Because it's like, I don't mean nothing else.
And the Lord must have said that I was going to be a warrior because I've been fighting since I came to this motherfucker.
That's what I did.
I think I got strawberries in my teeth too.
Yeah, we special, y'all. But no, so let's talk a little bit about personal experiences. So, because I'm really stuck on the police brutality thing.
They wanted me to stop staring into the camera, but I just love y'all so much.
So, about the whole police brutality thing, the stuff that is happening here in Dallas. We know the Clifton Allens. We know the
Jason Harrison, Jordan Edwards. Christian Taylor, RIP, who else, baby?
We got so many at the party.
That was Jordan Edwards, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. All of them babies, there's so many. What's the autistic man? Was he autistic? He was something that was shot in his back, and his mama was asking for help.
Jason, no, they shot him in the...
Jason Harrison? No, Jason Harrison was the white man, huh?
No, that was Hutchison.
Yeah, Hutchison. Jason Harris was the one who shot his baby.
It was mama right in front of his mama.
Mm-hmm. She called for help. And
I don't call the police, y'all. And I don't know what the alternative is because
we got a few brothers in the city, but really, it's so much stuff, and they be just
they don't have no jail to put you in or any type of punishment or anything established that they can do to punish you.
The whole, what was it?
Tribunal.
That shit don't work because it's just like the police shit. The judge and the jury be from the same goddamn clique. So where my fair trial is? We supposed to have stuff in place of people, of elders. We are supposed to have elders, and it's too many old folks that think they elders, but some of you niggas are just old.
Some of y'all, you gotta tell me where you finna play some real shit, cause I almost spit my shit out.
Some of y'all have the capacity to be elders and to teach us some things, but again, some of you niggas is just old, and age do not bring wisdom. It does not, and we need to stop just allowing people. Well, he got a dashiki and a black fist on and an ump around his neck. That's the elder. That ain't no damn elder. His wife, 22, okay, and she can't speak for damn self. So when it comes to things that have happened around the city, a lot of us have experienced different stuff. When I was 5 years old, I watched my father get beat by police. I never forget. I used to dream about it. When I was 5, I was at daycare, and my daddy came to get us to take us to get some ice cream. But my mama was mad at my daddy, and she told the school, "Don't let my daddy come and get us." My daddy said, "I'm just taking him next door to get us some ice cream. I ain't seen my daughters. I just want to take them to get some ice cream." He was like, "We going with our daddy. Leave my mom." So we went with my daddy. Okay, they was like, "We're going to call the police." He was like, "Cool." When they done having their ice cream, they come back. we'll see the police when we get here. And the, you know, he put me down and they brung us in this room and the police dragged my daddy out. I watched from the door of the, well, the window of the room that they put us in. All the kids is away from the window except for me. And I, like, I could still see it when I closed my eyes and I'm just watching throw my daddy on the ground, do all types of stuff. I had like five officers. I mean, I was five, so I might be seeing this totally different than my daddy. Always say they roughed him up a little bit, but it really wasn't that bad. To me, it was bad.
How is it that bad for the fact that you can't be a man and come see your child or come get your kids from daycare? Like, any roughing up is too damn much.
Just taking to see your the mom. Fact that they kids, your kids have to see that. Mm-hmm. I had to literally sit there and watch that happen to my daddy. That's when I was five. When I was 21, a Dallas police officer hit me with a car.
So did, man. That's
in front of a bunch of people. Damn, on the news, they said that I was a man that jumped into traffic. But the truth is, we was at a protest, and the officer was revving his engine. That's all you heard. And I had to be taken to the hospital because my adrenaline was rushing at first. Then when I came down, everything just shot down. I fell out. It's hard to press charges on them. It's hard to try to speak out your case and stuff like that. Because if you're not on it, it will go away. And then I went to the police station to try to get help with filing my report and everything. And they laughed at me.
Yeah, they did. Because that's how they do it.
They laughed at me in my face. And then when I was sitting down writing my report, they just kept talking. They was over there laughing, bringing other people over there to tell them what happened. They thought it was so funny. I had spent time in the booth. It was crazy. This is all in Dallas. I watched at a protest, a Trump protest, where my best friend got arrested for saying shit. They arrested him for some language, basically for cussing. And it was a woman, a white woman on the other side. She was cussing and she was doing all types of shit. They did not arrest her. She was for Trump. He was against Trump. He said shit. And they, five officers, drug him, slammed him up against the wall, put zip ties on him, and hauled him off. And I'm screaming, where are y'all taking him? I'm like, this black man, this black police officer came up at me, get out, because I was on the bar. I was standing on this rail. He was like, you know, move, get out the way. And I was like, I'm not going nowhere. And the white officer said, she don't have to move. She's fine.
And
he was like, but such and such. And I said, shut up, little nigga. I said, you don't have no rights, baby. I said, you see that? I said, you see how Master just told
me. White man just told me how to sit right here.
I said, I was okay. I said, you don't got no rights. The white woman said, I can't believe she just said that. That's so stupid, so ignorant. I said, yeah, I'm still standing on this rail. I'm not moving. And this white man right here that just said I can stand here, y'all ain't got nothing over him. Your white woman ass and your black nigga ass. You can't say shit because he just said I'm cool. And they just looked at me like all three of them just looked at me. And I was like, that shit kills me. And y'all think that y'all really have something. Y'all don't have no right. And then I watched as a white man got taken to the side because he was doing wrong too. So they didn't want my best friend to be the only arrest, right? So they took him to the side. One officer had held his hand behind his back like this, right? They waited until they got on the side where nobody could see them. We watching. We can see everything because we're on the Trump supporter side. We kind of snuck over there. So that's weird. So we the only ones. It was four of us. My best friend got taken away. So now it's three women. They took him to the side where the people against Trump couldn't see him. Dapped him up. Pat him on the back. Say, good job. Opened up the ramps and let him back into the protest. Then it was this man say, oh, they're professional protesters. They getting paid for this. Just pointing us, I mean, really going in, kept staring at us, kept doing all types of, it was so crazy, y'all. And I was like, this shit is funny. Then we went to go get my best friend out of a jail. We couldn't figure out where he was at. He wasn't in the system yet. In hours, we looking for him. So we had DPD down on Lamar. We go knock on the door to ask for help. And the officer says, every time I ask him a question, he answers me back with a question. Black man.
I say, you know, excuse me, I'm trying to figure out how to find my best friend. And he was like, how can you find him? And he, I mean, like, every time I ask a question, he would repeat the damn question back to me. I say, you know, I don't have time for this. He said, see, every time we try to help y'all, y'all want to give us a hard time. I said, sir, are you really going to help me? And he was like, am I really going to help you? I said, see, that's that shit right there. And I walked out. I said, fuck it, I don't have no time. We having to look back. It's a group of about 10 white men with Make America gray hats on, army fatigue. They decked out with Trump this. They got signs and everything. They go knock on the police door like we did. He let them in. It's a line of other officers giving them high fives and clapping as they walk in. It was officers that was in protest. Every time we think that we have somewhat of a little voice, it's always people out there that are trapping you, that are just waiting. They're not letting you, you know, we think, oh, we got freedom of speech and we can go out there and we can say what we want to say. No, because our riots are looked at as bad, but these white dudes that be killing people and setting up riots behind hockey games and shit like that, they heroes. That's cool. It's okay for them to set a police car on fire because they won. Not because they lost the hockey game, but because they won the motherfucking hockey game. We out there mad because CVS, Walgreens, and Walmart that took over our mom and pop shops, and we bringing that shit up because, you know, Rodney King was beat to death, or Freddie Gray was killed, or the Mike Browns, and stuff like that. But yet, we are animals. It's all types of stuff. And in this city, it's even worse because places like St. Louis, they can actually set off some, they will set off some things. Here, yeah, they will bury you and people will forget who the fuck you are.
If the beginning collaborators of our Dallas government, local government, were all Klan members, then everything that came out of government afterwards at least had some parts or portion of white supremacy, if not 100%. I personally don't give a damn if you white, black, green, or blue, if you're with white supremacy, you know, that's how I judge it, that's how I take it. I was saying to some people that were close to me that we need white allies. If they are the dominant culture, people think when I say dominant culture, I'm saying they're stronger than us. And they think I'm talking about they Vivian better than us. But that's not what I'm saying. We built everything. Like Dallas, another fact about Dallas is we were the first ones to get a traffic light system in the nation. Mm-hmm. Ironically enough. Invented by who? Gary Morris? Is that who invented?
Black man, huh?
You know, it was a black man, but I think it was Gary Morris. Somebody tell me who invented the, hey, baby, my cheering, JB's on his, he want to learn about these pile of tricks. You know, I haven't been telling everybody what we're talking about. We down to one viewer, Jesus. It must be just JB's and my baby. Okay? But we're talking about Dallas politics, pile of tricks, whatever you want to call it. We're breaking it down to Gary the nitty Morgan. Gritty. Gary Morgan.
Why are you trying to put two people on there? So who is this JP Knighton? He don't even look like he was around at that time. They still trying to put him on there. They out of line. They always trying
might
to
have get, added some shit to it.
They always trying to give a white man some type of credit for some shit that we did. Just like that. What's the nigga name? The Thomas Jefferson did not invent the light bulb.
Was it Thomas Edison or Thomas Edison?
Somebody. One of them niggas. Let me see.
I know because I had a discussion with a friend of mine about it the other day.
It was the president. No one president. Clearly it wasn't. Go ahead. Let's go back.
Thomas Edison. He went Thomas out in the rain with a key on
on a kite.
On a kite, yeah.
Really? He just magically.
He was harnessing energy. Dallas was the first city to get the traffic light in the nation by a black man. And it's so funny to me, because if they was really Klan members like they swear they are, like on October the 23rd, 1923, I believe, 24th, 1923, State Fair was built on white supremacy. Klan members and Klan supporters built
the state fair. We have the largest, most magnificent state fair in the nation.
We used to have nigger days.
Negro Appreciation Day. Uh-huh. And that didn't come to the 50s. But in the 1920s, they actually had a Klan Day. And Negro Appreciation Day was one day that you can go in there and mess around.
Enjoy the festivities.
So we got to figure out what we believe and why we believe it. We need to unlearn all the things that we've learned that's counterproductive to what we're doing. Because me, the more I study Dallas, I think Dallas owe us reparations. And we should push for that. Maybe every black person locally should challenge their local government based on the amount of oppression that they went through in that city to get what's owed to them, because we're definitely owed. I'm not one of those, all we got to do is think positive and pull ourselves up by our bootstraps.
I don't
own
no boots.
Man, if BD's been selling for $2 a bushel, I wouldn't have no goddamn boots. What we're going to have to do is accept the fact that slavery doesn't mean we were weak. If a 19-year-old bully fucks with a 10-year-old child, and the 10-year-old child has to submit to that bullying until he gets big enough, and I'm not saying we're smaller. Our population is smaller. A friend of mine told me that they pad the numbers, and I don't think that that's incorrect, but I don't think that they pad them to the point where that's not true. Because America is the dominant culture of the world, not just America. Mm-hmm. White supremacy, imperialism, hegemony. Let me see.
It's a global. That's what I was thinking. Global.
Hegemony. That's what it's called. It's global. All those words mean the same thing. So if you don't want to say white supremacy, which is exactly what it is, and you have a couple of more words, and you can even make up some of your own.
Whatever makes you comfortable.
I say white, I say dominant culture at times, and I am vastly misunderstood, and I laugh all the time because they didn't misunderstand Kanye. They knew what he was talking about. Oh, wait a minute, he's real deep. They see my work out here every day. She don't know what she's talking about.
Okay.
Because we got different methods to get to the finish line. One thing that we cannot deny, I don't go quoting history to nobody. Now, this Dallas history, you're gonna get down with that with us on this shit, because this is the den. And it's called the den because we from the D, the D. And this is what we'll do for the D. They know what I mean. If they follow,
I don't need nobody in our inbox talking about who, what you gonna do for that.
Well, I'm single, so they can get in my inbox and find out what I do.
I am too, but don't get in there because your feelings gonna be hurt.
I like this. I'm an activist for the D. I will be a pacifist for the D. I'm a Baptist for the D. I don't know what for the D. So I'm in my ride. Yeah, we matter in the D. Get fired on them bitches!
You really thought it was gonna come in on the beat? It's okay.
Come on, I see no change. Wake up in the morning and I ask myself, it's like worth living, should I blast myself? I'm trying to be a poor, even worse, I'm black. My stomach hurts, so I'm looking for a purse to snatch. Got to give a damn about a meat, bro. Pull a trigger, kill a nigga, he's a heat, bro. Get it back to the kid, to the hell, kid. One that's hungry mouth for the welfare.
Y'all follow y'all bitches.
And we did it this time.
We gonna find some fire for y'all. We working it out. If y'all stick with us, who with us? I don't think nobody on with us right now.
It's all right. It's okay.
Yeah, so good.
Don't be. They be watching. They just don't be on. They be like sitting on their phone looking at it, but not in it.
Is that what they doing? Mm-hmm. Is that why we say two viewers through the whole thing and turn around and it be 134 viewers at the end? I'm gonna build this shit all the way up. Lily says she ain't gonna stop till she get to the top. So they out there trying to grind and get it right now. We got to do it for these babies. We got to do it for the D. Because I don't give a damn who founded this motherfucker.
She done may got ideas that's going to set this shit off. Okay, maybe she's going to put a newsletter together. She already got ideas.
Y'all didn't even tell me if the newsletter was worthwhile or not.
I feel like y'all going to get it. Because y'all be wanting to know some stuff. Y'all want to know some stuff, but y'all scared to know some stuff. And that's the thing about it. Ignorance is truly bliss. When you think about it, it makes us feel good to not know certain things. Because you can live honky-dory, la, 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 la. If you don't know it's raining outside, then you can wear your booty shorts and your flip-flops and your midriff and be happy. But as soon as you turn on the news and find it's raining, now you got to put on some sweats and a goddamn rain boots. And it's just going to fuck your whole mood up, your whole day. That's how we feel. That's literally how we live our life. Because we do not want to know. We want to think that the system works for us. We want to think that God can fix all because we are saved by grace. And it is wonderful. But even the Bible say that prayer without work is dead. So all you motherfuckers out there thinking that I'm just going to pray about it. You praying for the strength. You praying for something to happen. And the thing is, God, whatever you believe in, is giving you the strength to be able to take care of yourself. But you too scared because you think that some white man and the sheep will come down and save you. It's not going to happen like that. Because it's going to be that person that you least expect that's going to be the one that's going to help you. Matter of fact, the least person that you expect is yourself. It's going to take us. It's going to take us opening our eyes. We cannot sit back and just continue to think that life is sheltered and that the government is going to help us and that the system is going to work for us. Because it ain't never worked for us before. So why is today going to be the day that all of a sudden it's going to work for us if we don't do anything to change it? We have children in this world. Every time somebody asks me, why you go out there? You got a child to live for. I'm going out there for my child. And I want my child to have strength. And when I die, I need my child to still stand up for something. I need my baby to know that this shit is not okay. To not think that life is just butterflies and rainbows and that everything is going to go happen. And the first time that something happens to her, she crumbles and dies because she don't know how to fight. She don't know how to go through it. She don't know what to do. And every time you guys sit there and act like nothing is going on, you don't want to look at it. You don't want to read it. You don't want to see the videos. I'm just going to keep sliding up. I'm not going to look at that. And you keep passing by that. When that shit happens to you, you're not going to know how to handle it. It's really going to mess you up. Too many people, when they family get killed by police brutality or something like that, they scared. They don't know what to do. We gotta be peaceful. Please go out here and be peaceful. But as soon as they don't get no justice, they talking about burning this shit down. No. Be peaceful. Keep the way you want to keep. Stop with all that bull, because if you're not going to stand up now, don't start standing up when family's bodies start dropping.
Let's talk about the PTSD that comes with being black and seeing the police. I'm going to tell y'all something. Your best friend gave me my proverbial nuts at the Sandra Bland protest. Do you remember? Remember? We was on Lamar, headed south, and they stopped us. Talking about y'all can't go. But y'all know the protesters, we can walk.
On the sidewalk. They said we can't
be on
the sidewalk.
We can't stop in loiter. So as they're stopping us, we're loitering. They didn't want us to go over there where them luxury high rises was, disturbing them good white folk.
Because we had already disturbed their hotel.
Baby, it was at least 12 police cars out there and 3 paddy
wagons. I had to talk to them officers.
They sent the black bald head detective. I hope he looking over there to talk to us and try
to distort our
rights.
To blend in.
Oh, he used to blend in with us.
But how my best friend figured out, LaShayan Shimwell. He said, so how long y'all think y'all gonna be out here? He said, y'all. Dude said, yeah, where y'all next move? Where y'all planning on going? He said, nigga, who is you? He said, what you mean? He said, but you keep talking about y'all. You out here with us. You not with us? It's supposed to be we. Hey, Josh, tell me how you leaving. He said, who is you? Come to find out, he a detective. My best friend said, hey, y'all, he not with us. Him right here, this is a detective. He keeps talking about y'all and where y'all going and what y'all doing. Watch out for him.
Keep going, we going. Shut this shit down.
Let me tell y'all something. I'm from Oak Cliff. I run Dallas. I done kicked it in South Dallas, West Dallas, East Dallas, Pleasant Grove. Did I say Oak Cliff?
Yeah.
Oak Cliff.
Where you from?
Singing Hills. Motherfucking Island Hills. Island Hills. Cedar Crest. It's another hill. It's another Singing Hills.
You just said it.
Okay. Well,
you said Singing Hills, and then we said Highland Hills.
Well, shit, y'all know I'm from around here.
And around the corner, okay?
And the police make my throat dry, make my knees buckle. And so when we was on that corner that night on Lamar headed south, I was ready to go home. I ain't gonna lie, I'm a G in every other aspect of life. But when it comes to them people, I know they can tap you on your shoulder and end everything that you thought was fruitful in your life. So as we stood there with LaShadian, he wasn't in our group at that time, and I was leery of him on that speaker. What you call that thing? The bullhorn. So the black detective came over there and he said, y'all gotta go back the other way. Y'all can't walk this way. He said, no, that's illegal. We taxpayers. Our taxpayer dollars pay for this sidewalk and we're walking on it. What you're doing is stopping us from walking, which means we're loitering right here. And that'll be y'all's excuse.
Because if you don't know them laws, they're going to tell you whatever they want to tell you. Just like when they pull you over in your car and they tell you that they can search your car, they cannot search your car. Do not allow them to sit without probable cause. They don't see nothing in your ashtray or nothing like that. They have no reason to sit over there and search your car. They're going to try to arrest you, and then they'll search your car and say that they are doing what, the inventory before the tow truck come and take your car. We don't know our rights, so they are able to do a lot of things to us. And when you know it, it shuts them up so quick, and they trying to figure out what else they can say to get you on something else.
You know our rights, baby. You went down the line on. He's like, you can't go. Our supervisor says you can't. He said, well, get your supervisor on the phone. We want to talk to the supervisor. And I'm going to tell you something, black man. That's what he told that black detective. He said, you see how they sent you out front and stood all these white men and white police and white detectives out here, but they sent you out here. And when it's, and we live streaming. So when it's found out that you are breaching our rights, guess who gonna be thrown up under the bus first? You, your black bald head ass. Okay, so he's standing there looking dumb, trying to figure out what he gonna say next. And he said, oh, I'm a supervisor. He said, okay, well, let me speak to your supervisor. What's your supervisor name? Well, it wasn't him, but was it Mike Rowland? Did Mike Rowland say that we couldn't walk south on Lamar? No, okay, well, was it, what's the man, what's the governor name? Was it Greg Abbott? That's at the time, Obama was the president. What he said, was it President Obama? Therefore, I was so impressed.
That's when I had to talk to the officer, because he was like, well, what can the sergeant, the captain, he said, so what can we do? I said, well, first of all, we're on the sidewalk. I say, so the first thing that you can do is you can tell your officers to put their guns down. What they got their guns on? I said, where is we going to go? It's a whole line of y'all. I said, where the hell is we going to go? We going to run through y'all? We don't have no guns. We don't have no nothing. I said, so I'm going to. You're right. I said, y'all really making a big deal. And at this point, the protest had went down. It was probably about maybe 20 of us at this point. What the fuck is we going to do? Y'all got bands and everything. Let us finish what we doing and let us finish riding ourselves up, doing whatever we doing. I said, let us go. If you feel like that's the thing, I said, but move the fuck out the way. Why are y'all here? I don't understand. It's a whole lot of things, man. Then they would try to manipulate you, put people in that look like you. Think about it. The Panthers was infiltrated by somebody that looked like them. Come on, man. We know this. If you even watch the movie, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's hard because they put your family on the line. They put you in stuff. So, I mean, we can all say what we going to do, and I'll die for the revolution. But what happens when they come in and they start saying about, well, your mama got to take the charge, or somebody else got to take it. Now you fucked up, and you like, well, damn. I'm going to let you niggas go because my mama ain't got nothing to do with this. Y'all fighting, you know what I'm saying? And this shit is, it's so much in it, man. It's so much. And then we get so scared and we stop talking and we don't want to be out there no more, especially not front and center. Man, I'm going to be behind closed doors. I'm going to talk my shit. So it's like, when you here, I'm quiet. But when you leave, I be talking to you. Like, we, when Dallas is so separate, there's so many people here doing the same shit, but on different spectrums. You know what I'm saying? We got this organization over here, then we got this organization over here, and they don't want to come together because somebody got to be able to lead. When in reality, I don't give a fuck who leads. Each one of us, if you can speak, you ain't stuttering, and you can talk well for yourself, you should be able to speak. You should be able to say something. Even if you do stuff, maybe we'll take a couple extra minutes to let you get it out, slow it down, and speak it to us. You know what I'm saying? Everybody should be able to have a voice, but we have to come together. The more separated we are, the more they're going to divide us, the more they're going to come, and they're going to attack us, hurt us, and everything else. There's so much to this. And it's going to take us learning some things. It's going to take us to get out of ourselves and stop being so ignorant and accepting of what has been given to us and say, shit, it was actually a white man that said, it was a civil rights police that he said that war, what did he say? That freedom is not given, it's won. That's so true. Like, it's not, you have to fight for everything that is yours. You're going to have to fight for it. You have to take it. You can't just sit around and think that somebody is going to give it to you. Somebody who doesn't even think highly of you. Somebody who doesn't think that you're even worth anything. It's going to give you something. It don't work like that. Just like respect is not given, it's earned. Freedom is not given, it's won. We're going to have to stand up for some things. There's not a lot of y'all on here. I think y'all might be watching from different areas and not actually being on here. Rashida had to step out for a second. But we're talking about Dallas politics. Politics, whatever y'all want to say it is, because we want to believe in a system so bad. We actually had a guest that was supposed to come and talk to y'all about voting and things like that and why it's important to vote. So many people that feel like it's not, my voice don't matter, why am I voting? I'm voting people that still gonna be against me, whatever. We have to get our people in office. My best friend ran for city council last year. He ran against a man that had a lot of money. He ran while he was living in the projects, didn't have a whole lot, and has children that he has to take care of, children that he was a single father of. And he ran. Him and his kids went out and went door to door. I went out with him one time, went door to door for hours with each other. Had to do that because he has a voice that needs to be heard. The man ended up having a runoff election. And they had 96% return on voting. That has never happened in the city of McKinney, ever. He is the second black man in 170 years of the city to even be in such a position. He got dread tattoos.
Yes!
And they say that, he has a felony case, not a felony charge, a felony case. And that man is the city councilman, and he is kicking ass. And the city councils in McKinney only make $25 they make pennies, okay, for you know a term or whatever. So he's still cutting hair, he's still doing different things, but he is making these moves. We have to get our people, stand behind our people and get them in office. We have to literally fight for them, go out there, because the only way that we're going to see changes in their world is if we get in there and actually have a voice. You got to have a seat at the table to be able to have a voice. You can't be next door talking about, I want some of that food. You need to be at the table to get a little bit, to get some crumbs or anything. If you ain't there, you ain't going to get it. And, it's going to take us. Voting matters, but voting matters more when we run. Voting matters more when we stand behind our people and let them know that if they get out there, the ones that's brave enough to be able to stand up, I was supposed to run. And eventually I'm going to run. I'm not there yet, but I will be there. And that's when we're going to start seeing some change. And it's truly when we're going to start seeing some change. Oh, okay. All right. We have, I figure it's coming in like a few minutes. So excited.
And we just can't hide it. We got the looks and talk, and we think we like it. He found me, bitch.
Worship them, don't let them kill the brothers. Keep them down, step back, watch them kill each other. It's time to fight back, that's what he said. Two shots in the dark, now he's dead. I call for my brother, but we can never live no way. Let's be shit.
How you doing?
We gotta stop making changes.
Nothing but a seat over here.
And that's how it's supposed to be. I give it double, take a run, they're close to me.
I'm not going
back to the place, kids, it's a shame.
Ladies, I can't sing like Rashida.
Things will never be the same.
Hey, it's a man in the den. Pastor Damian Madison, thank you so much for coming and joining us. Lily and I aren't much interested in politics like that, but as we delved into the city that has done us no justice, that we've had a very hard time, and we found out a lot of the reasoning behind what's going on. Our original founding government were all Klan members. Like, Dallas is a Confederate monument. But let's fast forward to today, and we're going to talk about voting, and, you know, we're not going to cuss because Pastor Madison here. We respect
it for the war.
welcome.
Thank you for having me. Appreciate you. Glad to be here.
I've been well. Very proud of the things that we're trying to do here in Dallas. Okay. Pastor Madison has helped many, and he's very active. You know, we fight a lot. I'm not per se a Christian. You know, they say Jesus wasn't a Christian, so I'm kind of like Jesus in that sense. So I give pastors a hard time for not joining in on some of this very relevant content that we speak about, especially because they have huge congregations, and it could, I'll say it like this. We are hugely democratic in our Black community, but only 5% of us come out to vote. And to affect change. And I think that these pastors could be very instrumental. That's why Pastor Madison is one of my favorites.
I am.
Yes, absolutely. And we ate all the snacks.
I see what's over there.
I mean,
you got some cups somewhere. You can drink whatever you like.
I'm on that side over there, but it's all good.
Some goldfish.
Oh, really?
Some goldfish.
The Lord ain't through with me yet.
Water.
It's wine.
Right. He found it.
So far, we've talked a little bit about our personal experience with police brutality. We've talked about a lot of the hidden history.
Should we reiterate some of the...
We can flow. I mean, you know, I think I'll kind of bounce off of you, and then I'll bounce off of you. I think one of the things that I love what you said, you know, how a lot of pastors don't use their platform to affect change or confront the issues that exist. Mm-hmm. Within our communities. One of the things that always bothered me growing up on the Chicago South Side. Right. And so one of the things that I always wondered was, why was the church the best living thing on the block? Right. And so you have all these churches in the neighborhoods, you got, I mean, all these storefronts down the block, but all the same issues were just as pervasive as they were before, with the church being present, right? And so it would bother me to watch all these folks drive in and get nice cars in the church and go have a good time for worship, I mean, and shout, but then get in the car and drive off back to your home somewhere else and never affect change and everything to the way you're worshiping, right? And then, you know, but then once we studied the history of Black church, you know, one of the things that we don't see as much today as we should that was very present in history is the Black church was the voice of change. It was the voice of consciousness. It was the voice of relevance. And so we look at the history, I mean, from burning John. I mean, again, a pre-Martin King, you know, Martin King is with, it's one that we like to, you know, market and moniker, and we even sanitize, because we know when you look at the true message and voice of King, that's why they killed him.
Right.
It wasn't because he was a go along and get along kind of captain, because he actually wanted to affect change, especially when it came to, you know, economic change. But anyway, but you look at Vernon Johns, I mean, just the history of, I mean, even the history that we know of, when we know, we talk about, you know, even Harriet Tubman, Frederick Douglass, a lot of people don't know that they were preachers, you know, so we have a history of the preacher being a voice of change.
I didn't know that.
And so this book you should read is called Preaching with Sacred Fire.
It's
Preaching with Sacred Fire.
Preaching with Sacred Fire.
That's a big book.
Y'all, book buffs. Y'all go get that and read it.
And actually, it has sermons from a lot of people that through our history, but we did not realize were actually preachers that we know that we tell them. You know, so the church has been a voice. The SCLC that came from, you know,
that's
the
right.
Church. I mean, so. But then you move to a current time when we have allowed this prosperity theology. We've allowed the all about me context. That was churchism. No, touch this. you know, we allow all this stuff that, you know, that's actually it's washed down the part of the gospel. When we look at the Bible, you know, historically, meaning that. The Hebrew language, the words righteousness and justice actually are interchangeable, because to understand God's righteousness, you have to know God's justice. And so to know justice is to know righteousness. I mean, so there's a whole lot that we don't deal with in scripture anymore that we used to in history. And so, so to your point, you know, I mean, there are more of us. And there are those who are out there, you know, Freddie Haynes. I
love Freddie Haynes. Y'all my two favorite. I really don't. Dominique Alexander.
Right. But yeah, you know, Freddie Haynes, John Faison in Nashville. I mean, you know, there are a lot of cats who are still trying to hold out the banner of, you know, what justice looks like, you know, in ministry. So yeah, you know, we got to roll with it. And then to your point. You know, you have thought into the whole notion of police brutality. It's really, I mean, one of the things that we cannot do, we cannot hide behind our faith and not confront the issues that we see that our faith should be changing.
So what's an example of hiding behind our faith? Because people don't think that's what they're doing.
Oh, I'm just going to leave it up to Jesus.
You can leave your business up to Jesus. About the fact that, you know, we feel like, oh, let's pray about it, and then, you know, even the Bible says pray without work is dead. You are praying for somebody to come down and save you, for a savior to come and just take all your problems away like it's a magic magician, and not thinking of the fact that you're praying and God is giving you the strength to take care of it yourself.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Or sending someone, your sister, who you think is not that strong, to be able to help you through it. Like, we don't look at those things, and we were talking about the fact that ignorance is bliss. A lot of times we don't want to know the things that are going on, because it feels good to just think that everything's okay and it's wonderful and la la land and what, you know, whatever. And to just say that, you know, the system will take care of itself, or if I don't, it's like the monster underneath the bed. If I hide underneath my covers, it can't see me. I can't see it.
Girl.
You know,
that is a perfect example.
I mean, I mean, you know, point. I mean, you know, we know that we think, you know, we can pray things away. And here's the thing: it's not saying that prayer doesn't work. It's not saying that we can't. But if we look at scripture in context, and we look at how God has actually operated, God has always called people and used people to be an answer to a problem. Moses, go tell Pharaoh to let my people go. You know. So now. Now, when Moses was obedient and did what God called him to do, what actually happened, the actual impact was the Lord provided his power and his strength and undergirded him to bring about an effective change that he called him to handle.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so somebody somebody's have to be willing to actually take that leap of faith and step out and say, you know what, maybe I'm not sent you. And so, but we can't hide behind, we can't hide behind our shout and our song and just think that it is just going to disappear magically. Yeah, I mean, again, even in scripture, now there, you know, more often than not, there was human responsibility that had to intersect with God's divinity. And so we have to own some stuff. We have to do some things. And we can't close a blind eye to what we see in the world. We can't close our eyes and ignore the fact that, you know, that God wants to use us to make a difference, make a change. And so, we gotta stop being so deep, being so heavenly minded that we're no earthly good.
Earthly good.
And we gotta stop playing.
Yeah. I agree. What do you think? You know, we always talk about that the local elections are the elections that matter. But me not being a political person per se, I'm political as it pertains to my thought process. Oh, we need better this, the schools, this, poverty, that. But as far as who to vote for, I find that I'm not impressed often by any other candidates. So what, in your opinion, do you think we should glean from that? Should you vote when you don't agree with either one?
Yes. And here's the thing. And I'll use our most recent election presidential. I've heard a lot of my fellow African American Negro friends. Some of what you have said things like, well, I just couldn't feel, I couldn't pull myself to vote for either candidate. Now, when you're looking at the context of what we're talking about here in terms of, okay, I get it, you may not like either candidate. But you have to realize when you don't vote, you still vote. Yep. What you've done, you actually enhance a platform for the person you know is more dangerous. And so I'm not saying that it's a logical thing to vote the lesser of two evils, but sometimes it's an impactful thing to vote the lesser of two evils.
How do you determine the lesser of two evils? Because evil is not one to jump out there and say, hey, I mean,
that's what scared me about the whole thing, because I don't do that. And it was a wolf, and then it was a wolf in sheep's clothing. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, damn, like I want to see what you know what I'm saying? I don't want the friend that's gonna shoot me in my back. I want to know where my enemy is at. And so I mean, I actually voted for a third party. I voted, but I could not. And my daddy to this day would tell me over and over again, you sound stupid, you so dumb, you vote for Hillary. I didn't, in my mind, in my heart, that's not who I believed in, but I feel like my vote still counted. And I feel like the local elections are the most important. So I really want to make my voice, we were just talking about that a second ago. We have to start getting our people in office. We have to get us more grassroots to start learning some stuff and saying, okay, I'm going to go out and I'm going to run. My best friend ran in McKinney. He's the second black man in 170 years of the city to be a city councilman. He got dreads, tattooed, and a felony case, plus he has 13 children.
He read
on and that he wasn't going to be able to do it. He ran while he was living in the projects in McKinney.
The projects.
You know what I'm saying? He had a bus. He was busing elderly people every night before he even ran to the grocery store because they don't have a bus there. A lot of things that he did, him and his children, on foot, we're going door to door, and I went with him as well. They had a runoff. He had 96% return on voting. That has never happened in the city of McKinney. We have to stand behind our people that say, hey, I'm going to stand up and I'm going to do it. Like Dominique Torres, she ran. She lost the election. We should have really pushed and stood behind her more. It's so many of us that
my girl,
we need to make sure that we stand behind them, because it is hard when you like, okay, well, she black, but I don't really trust her. He's sitting over here and he don't look nothing like me. And I know he bad. She look familiar, but she's going to be the one that makes me feel the most comfortable and take me out. I know he going to take me out. I don't want either one of y'all. But we have to get our people to stand up and say, all right, well, I'm going to be the one to run.
oh, who want to do that? That's scary. I don't want to be a part of it. Or the people that say, well, Huey P. Newton said that we can't change the system. We're going to get in there and it's going to take over us and stuff like that. I love Dr. Huey P. Newton. I think he was in every way a genius. But we have to learn the system in order to infect it.
Right.
Well, talking about Dallas politics, y'all.
No. I mean, I didn't think, you know, we should go a step further. I mean, I love what you said. But to really infuse the whole church piece into it is this. I think, I mean, even, you know, not a church, but even, you know, a lot of our Black organizations, we got to get to a point where we start to actually begin to raise up, develop, emanate our own candidates. You know, one of the things when you look at the other side is they, you know, when folks finish college, when they go to high school, when they're born, you know, they're told, this is what you're going to do when you finish school. This is what you're going to do. And so, and then not only that, they put their money behind them, right? And so I think one of the things that we have, you know, we have to get to the point where we begin to develop, nurture, train, support, and enhance our own people to put them in the places and put them in position to run for office. And you're right, you know, when we begin, and even starting that locally, you know, is that, you know, actually, you know, training folks and supporting them, you know, and people who have our interests at heart, people who have, and beyond that, we also have to start caring about crafting and shaping our own policies. You know, it's, you know, if, you know, we just can't put folks in office, but then have nothing to give them at the table and say, hey, look, this is what we need you to do. And so we, too often, we're silent on the areas that matter. You know, I mean, I'm excited, I'm elated, I'm glad that we have had the first African-American president in Barack. I mean, that was great. But while we were partying, while we had all these galas and these balls and, you know, having a good time, everybody else had policies they were crafting and putting at his table. And so while we complain about things, while we complain about some of the outcomes, I mean, even locally, what are we crafting as a community to make sure that our voices are heard and change the impact?
Well, we gotta examine people's interests as well, because I celebrated to the umpteenth power when Barack Obama got into office, and I can't lie, when he left, I was very disappointed because there was no policy put into place or no policy that was asked for on our behalf. On the behalf of Native American Blacks, descendants of slaves. And then you have to size everybody up, you know, big up, shout out to Yvette Cornell and Antonio Moore. I watch their podcast all the time, and they speak about sizing everybody up. But when you look at Barack Obama, he didn't really let anybody down but Michelle. Michelle is Native Black, a descendant of slaves. His mother is Caucasian and his father is Kenyan. He's had some experience. Of course, he's gone through some of the things that define Black Americans, whatever Black is. But the policies represented the fact that he didn't really relate or understand our struggle. Y'all have anything to say to that, or?
You know, we can wrap that all night.
We gotta size people up when we're getting ready to send them out there to load the bases for us or whatever. We gotta check them out. We gotta see where they come from, because people like we were talking about Kanye when we first started out, and that very detrimental statement that he made that's got our youth going crazy on the internet. And that he was on the slavery block as he said it. If you were watching, you would understand that. If you knew anything about the history of anything, you would understand that. But so we're hailing him as a free thinker when white supremacy has been saying that for the longest. Oh no, slavery, it wasn't that bad, and we was nice to the slaves, and you know, all they had to do was opt out of slavery. And I don't like laughing or joking or
we're not even slaves anymore. In the Texas school books,
we were indigenous servants. And they talk about it, it's like a page on slavery.
I'm not gonna cuss the pastor here.
But it's
y'all know I get upset about that type of talk.
There are different forms of slavery. We think of slavery, we think of the whips and chains and the, you know, the real life stuff that you can see and the beatings and the kiting and blah, 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 blah.
The police do but it every day the on fact, the block. Yeah, the fact you've that been had martial law in the hood forever.
We are mentally enslaved. The fact that, you know, the penitentiaries are loaded with us and they are in there making stuff for the outside world, you know, for low price.
25 cents an hour or something. They make toothbrushes, they make tires, they make apparel, they make all kind of stuff.
A lot of people
furniture.
A lot of people talk about Dominique Alexander. They talk about the fact that one of the cases that he got, I have to bring it up just for the simple fact that the main thing that boy will say about that case is that he was young and could not afford an attorney. So a lot of us, we get in these systems and they say, well, if you say you did it, we'll just give you probation. Okay, I did it. You ever watched that movie, American Violet? You ever say, I love that movie. It's a true story about a chick. Not watching tonight. And they had a raid. They kept raiding these apartments. What was the apartments called? It was called something, whatever. But they kept raiding these apartments. You know, everybody was for drugs, and when we found out a lot of the people was not dealing drugs or even on drugs, they was just raiding it. And then the people would get into jail and they would be so scared the fact that they were there, nobody would fight for their case. And so everybody would take a deal. Well, when they took the deal, they lost their housing, they lost all their government assistance, all types of stuff. So now they are butt out. You know. And one chick, she actually fought. She said, no, I'm taking this to trial. I did not do anything, and I'm going to fight it. And everybody was like, don't fight it, you know. The kids don't have to deal with this. You got to go to prison. It's a whole bunch of stuff. But it's so many of us that do not fight cases because we cannot afford a lawyer. Nobody's going to listen to our story. We just some black kid from such and such and such and such. I'm just from the projects. I'm just from here. I don't have anything. Who's going to believe me? And I might as well just take this charge. I might as well just take this. How many of us are felons behind something that they didn't do? Just like that boy in Rikers who ended up killing himself when he was finally released from prison behind a crime he did not commit. Behind a crime that he did not commit. That boy was young and he was like 16 when he was sent to federal prison. That boy had been raped, beat by officers, all types of stuff. That boy was so mentally messed up that after the documentary it did for him, he shot himself. You know what I'm saying? That is a bondage that no one can take you from. It's easy to take shackles off your feet. It's easy to take ropes and stuff from you. But how do you take somebody from that mental prison because you have locked them inside of something? I know a lot of people that have been taken to jail and literally lost in the system. We have a friend who was protesting, got arrested, and was lost in the system for 2 days. Hmm. And then they just let her out. They didn't push no charges on her, nothing. Literally, that hoe walked out the prison.
We got a friend that just got released that was locked up
on a misdemeanor. For a misdemeanor.
Feds for a misdemeanor. Now he out. No charges. But he was in there for how long? At least 5 or 6 months. I'm going to say 4 months because I don't know. I know this is the new year or you know, kind of it's getting on towards the middle of the new year. But we are beautiful, magical people because even in shackles, whether they be literal or figurative, we are free in our minds. And that's big. And that's why the comments that you guys are leeching on to from Kanye, because you feel like it gives you empowerment, is so disrespectful. We are survivors. And that's pretty much what we're talking about. Dallas politics and how we can maneuver through some of these things. There's some knowledge that'll get you through.
It's one of the fun facts, or not so fun facts, that I want to share again, because I don't know that y'all digest some of this stuff. We say,
before you go too far, I'm gonna, if I can.
You can.
I want to ask myself to the whole Kanye piece that I think that is really worth
speaking.
Yeah, I'm not the smartest guy in the world, but I think Kanye's comment was really a demonstration of somebody who's just trying to divorce themselves mm-hmm. from the reality of oppression, from the reality of racism, from the reality of injustice, from the reality of what our people have gone through, for the sake of acceptance and for the sake of affirmation and for the sake of income. When you look at what Kanye has done, you write a song about gold diggers and marry one.
When he get on, he leave for a white girl and then.
All right. So when you look at Kanye and the context upon which he's functioning in, you know, he's a narcissist. Mm-hmm. You know, it's all about him. Mm-hmm. And so for him, that comment one gave him a public platform to push his album when it went on the drops. Number one, number two, it shows you how broken his mindset was. And so it's the point that you all just dropped about, you know, in slavery, mass incarceration, the whole context. The reality is, slavery worked. When you look at the output, the outcome, and the mental incapacitation that came from slavery, the fact that, we talk about nothing, we discuss PTSD for folks who've been at war. We have to deal with, the PTSD for those who have been enslaved. Because you're looking at 400 plus years of an entire, no other culture in this world has had to deal with the oppression, the segmentation. The stripping of entire culture and mindset and humanity. No other culture in this world have had to endure that. And watch this. And so you want to say it was choice? You have an entire people who had to begin our humanity in this country 400 years behind the curve. So when you deal with economics, when you deal with academics, you got to realize, I love what you said, because we are masterful. We are blessed, because with a 400-year head start, we still here. We're mm-hmm. still standing. We got no we're degreed. Our folks don't know we're still living. No, we are nowhere near where we should be. I mean, as people who have been oppressed for so long, right. That's amazing right. in itself. Right. Now, but the reality is, we still have so far to go. Because right. again, to your point, the mindset that comes with oppression, we underestimate. No, we know, again, economics. No, we weren't even allowed to be a part of the economic system for years. We couldn't own anything. I mean, then you move toward and then you would think in the 60s, things would be better. No, we still can own property. Because we were redlining, and so we weren't even issued loans in our area. Because why? They didn't want us to own property, to obtain wealth. So we have to look at the fact that this entire system mm-hmm. that we have lived in, this entire construct, we have to really deconstruct, and so we actually can have a chance at justice. I mean, so I love how you want to again discuss localization and politics and all that, but we have to confront not just a system. For a culture that was designed on purpose to preclude Ooh. Progress mm-hmm. of those folks who are deserving of purpose.
Mm-hmm. Unlearning the damaging things that you learn that prevent you from progress. Today we're talking about local politics, whatever you want to call it. We've gone over, it's very interesting that you just said what you said, because we began talking about Willie Lynch. A lot of people debate and say Willie Lynch wasn't real, but whatever that was, that they got that the commentary from on that letter, is very real. And we see the effects of it today. And we learned that after integration that we was able to become or whatever we could. And the reason why we in ghettos is because we're lazy and dumb. I told them earlier that interestingly enough, even though Dallas was founded by a Confederate supporter, a trader of Indians, a proponent of slavery, we were the first to get first city in the nation to get the traffic light invented by a black man. So these are the things we gotta unlearn. Unlearn feeling inferior. And they say we feel inferior. I debate that. I don't think we feel inferior. I feel great. It's the obstacles that I fight every day that show me that I'm a second, third, or fourth class citizen. And I would argue that I'm a fourth class citizen. Not in my mind, but in the minds of the makers of the system that has so many inner systems within it that work so well against us.
When you spoke about Martin Luther King, Dallas told Martin Luther King, he couldn't come here.
Right.
He was not welcome. The black people told him he was not welcome. We didn't want that. Because back to that ignorance is bliss. We don't need you coming up here shaking up nothing. We are content with the little stuff they keep giving us. And we're gonna keep you patient until they give us a little bit more and a little bit more and a little bit more. You come in here and then we're gonna start getting killed and things gonna start happening. We don't want
them. I'm one of the good ones. I'm not like them troublemakers.
When we think of Martin Luther King, too many people think that Martin Luther King was killed because he was trying to bring us together. That is not why Martin Luther King was killed.
Come on, preach to him.
He was not murdered because he was integrating us. Yay. One of the last things that Martin Luther King said was, I feel like we're going to rent integration, but I feel like we're integrating into a burning. Think of burning buildings.
Burning house. Yeah. Fun.
So with that being said, and that's why he was taken out so fast after him and Malcolm X were supposed to meet and all of these different things were supposed to happen, because he was starting to understand that maybe we actually should have some things for ourselves. Maybe a little bit of separation and segregation is not bad. Not to say that we don't need these rights and stuff like this, but we have to learn and start doing things for ourselves and stop asking certain things. You know what I'm saying? Because when we allow others to teach our babies everything, then they can say that slavery didn't exist and we were just indigenous servants, that we were just, that this is something that we wanted and things like that. We have to have something to ourselves. We have to learn some things for ourselves. And that is what got Martin Luther King killed. That is what has taken out a lot of our people, not for trying to bring us together, but for thinking outside of what the powers that be kind of want you to think. Or whatever, what seems like what is against the agenda, if I say that. You know what I'm saying? Anything that has you truly standing up for yourself is what kind of changes things. When we hear the "I have a dream" speech, that's not even the name of the speech.
Right.
And it's not even the whole part of it. It was like hours. We heard like 20 minutes of it and it was like, that's the part we're going to use. That's what we're going to talk about in school. That's what we like. When we think about our heroes and stuff like that, you have to dig deep into their full life. Really study them, not just what they give you and the little pieces and a little bit of history that they talk about, because there's so much more to it. My daughter goes to an all-girls preparatory. It's an amazing school. They learn about wonderful women in history. I think it's the best school ever because my baby is learning how to be a young woman. She went to an African-based homeschool co-op last year, so she learned about being black. Now she's learning about being a woman. She is so black. Y'all, she's the only person in the kindergarten that does not stand for pledge. The only person. And when they asked her, she said, "The flag don't represent me." And
when I come to get her from school sometimes, she tells me how to be black sometimes too.
she is so beautiful in her innocence, because
my baby is looking into everything, and that's something that we have to instill in our children. This thing, and she would come home and tell me that I didn't even know. You know what I'm saying? She's talking about Marcus Garvey, people that we don't even speak about to our kids because we don't want to learn for ourselves. And say, if you want to hide anything from a black man, put it in a book.
No, it's interesting. You brought up King again. Now, a lot of people, when you actually study King, actually read his writings and read his books and actually dissect his speeches, he didn't just want integration. Integration was never really the MO. The MO was justice. Integration was a byproduct of what happened. But you know, again, it was about justice. And so we have to really understand that, you know, a lot of the King that we study is the whitewashed, sanitized, you know, watered down version of King. But it wasn't just having access to their, you know, to the other world. The objective actually was supposed to be having that same access no matter what world you lived in. And so, you know, and you're right, you know, King, you know, again, you know, was killed, and you know, not because he was happy or lucky, but, you know, of course, when you start, you know, trying to deal with economics, you know, trying to, you know, mess with the money, that's going to become a problem as well.
Yeah.
You know? So I think we really have to understand, you know, and even look at history and dissect, you know, what happened to us as a people when we integrated.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how we always had this mindset that white was better.
Yep.
We had this perspective that, you know, that their water was colder. You know, we had this, you know, this thought that if I can just, you know, if I can just be affirmed and assimilate, lose myself in the process, I'll be all right. And which leads to comments like Kanye, you know, or Larry Elder, you know, or
Lil Cool J. That racism doesn't exist anymore.
Girl, don't tell me LL says that.
Yeah, things like that, because white is pure. When you look up, when you look, Google beauty,
right,
you see hundreds of pictures of white.
If you
women,
Google
you don't
anything, see, you're going to have to put African American or black.
If you Google God, you're going to see, right. See the
Borgia. And if you and you mess around and Google black beautiful women, and they gonna show you some white women that's wearing black, so you better say African American or Negro or something like that,
you know,
cause they right. Not playing out here.
Right. Yeah.
It's very profitable to denounce who you are and where you are from, and to be one of the good Negroes.
I'm not like the mother nigga.
I'm sorry, pal. I said that N word. I don't like calling it the N word though, because everybody know what you're saying.
You know, it's so crazy. You know, you can make comments like that when you got money.
Yeah.
Because it
doesn't
allows
affect
you to live in a world where you aren't impacted by the things that actually exist. And so that's why we got to be careful. You know, who we listen to. Who, I mean, again, back to where the talk began in terms of politics, and whatever it is, you got to be careful who's on that stage and who you buy into, because again, their social formation may, you know, it directly impacts their policy, because their understanding of society is not one that most of us live through every single day. You know, so again, you know, again, our social construct allows and affords too many people to be divorced from the realities that still exist today. The only reason someone like a Kanye can say that because he can afford to live somewhere where he isn't impacted by that. But Ray Ray and them, down the street, you ask them about racism, they know it's there. You ask them about this brutality, they know it's there. Why? Because we're living it every single day. And so, you know, again, context is everything.
Yeah. We believe when we get $5 over bill money that we balling, and we gotta stop that, because what I find interesting at now time, I'm gonna read some of these comments in a second so that we can connect with our viewers. But we get a couple of bucks over lunch money and bill money. It's hard to tell these folks that they still black.
it's actually a little bit depressing because I know where it comes from. We hold a lot of shame. We hold a lot of shame. And although I don't believe that Kanye was necessarily just looking for attention, or he was saying it because he just wanted to impress the white man, I think he really had to say that. Because it was a whip somewhere. You know how your mama used to get the belt and crack it? Pop, pop, pop. Somebody somewhere, let them know.
But when you were talking about thinking of context, I had a conversation with this man. I mean, my best friend.
Interrupt me.
Used to sit. You had paused. Me and my best friend used to have conversations in the barbershop all the time because he cut hair. So I'd be like the only woman in there. We killing them on different, you know, topics and stuff, right? Where was this dude that was the same color as my phone? Okay, but he's black. And he said that police brutality don't affect him and his kids, and it's not going to affect him and his kids. His kids is mixed. I fell out my chair. I literally slid out the chair. And I said, you got to be kidding me. I said, your kids going to be affected more than anybody else. I said, they don't even know what side to be on. It's going to be so much they're going to have to deal with and try to understand themselves, because they're going to be, especially living with you thinking that they're better than everybody, they're going to be real sad when they actually have to deal with somebody who still sees them as, excuse me, just a nigga. They see them as just, because what is it, if you a fourth black, you black.
Yeah, one drop of that blood.
You are,
but you're three-fifths of a human being.
As far as your, that vote used to count. That's so funny to me.
I beg to differ that it still counts.
It's so funny because people think that the paper bag, you know, test, like, that's real. Well, I'm light and bright. I hate that light skin and dark skin. Oh, teen light skin, teen dark skin, chocolate all over everything. I'm sexy because I'm bright. Like, that is so dumb to me. Because at the end of the day, you is still black. I don't care whether you the whitest. They had a picture of this albino man. He was like the brightest black man, and then they had the blackest black man, and it was so beautiful just to see them white together. But I don't care what it is, baby. Your features and everything, we still know you black. Michael Jackson changed. He did a lot, but he was still black. And when he had
Michael B, kids, we appreciate you, black.
But all of that stuff is just. It's gonna take us.
Shanae is Coco. That she was just telling you what color she is.
I'm mocha, but
you turn your phone down.
It's just going to take. It's gonna take all of us to understand that it's so much more to it than this. And if we don't come together at some point and start to understand that no matter what, they see us all the same, we're gonna lose every time. No matter what. I don't care if you the brightest one and I'm the darkest one. When they see us together, if they gonna kill us, if they say right now, I'm going out and killing every black person I see, they're not gonna say, well, you kind of light skinned. I'm not gonna shoot you. I didn't say light skinned black people, I said brown skinned black people. No, they gonna kill you. Everybody gonna die. We have to stop separating ourselves, and I don't know, man. As time go by, we get more dumb with the stuff that divides us, like.
Because we have so many mixed messages. I'm going to read some of y'all's comments so you'll know that we love you and you are a part of this. We got 8 minutes left. I'm going to read some of these comments, and then we're going to have final thoughts from our panel, our host panel today. So let me see what y'all over here talking about. Bev said, white boys understand race relations early. For some reason, so many parents prefer to shelter their child. I agree. We're such the when they go low, we go high community that, you know, we just teach our kids to endure everything and don't fight back and don't say nothing. You just pull yourself up by the bootstraps and it's your fault. We just teach them that. So I agree with that so much. Karen said, we need voters' education for our community. That's why we're going to make this a two-part show. I don't know if we're going to come back next week with the second part or if we're going to plan and kind of get some thoughts together. So we'll get back to y'all on when the second part is going to be. But we definitely need to
use this platform that we have to get together on that.
A lot of these topics gonna be twos.
Karen also said, we must go back to the basics before we can get proper representation for our people. Our people must understand the political process. And that is one of the hardest things, because I don't want to learn the political process. I was born, I woke up like this, in bondage. But I'm going to tell you, even though I'm weary, I'm smart enough to understand that most of our progress has been through legislation. We didn't put ourselves in this position. So government is going to, who put us here, is going to have to intervene. We are poverty stricken as it comes to structure. And the structure that we depend on is largely made up of arrests, beatings, killings, just like in the beginning of the starting of America or whatever. Mm-hmm. So I get it. Sade said, who that man back there? Who that man? That's Pastor Damian Madison. Don't you ask who he is no more. You better recognize and put some respect.
Look, you don't want to take a break now. We just
on his name. You know that girl gonna say something fly every time. She just fly like that.
Cannot help it. You know, I'm the oldest.
She said, we traded her for the pastors. You know, you got to get out there and hustle and get it and come on back when you get a chance. Jan is watching. And Michael B said, I appreciate what I'm hearing since I'm tuned in. I appreciate you tuning in. I want y'all to go to YouTube and like and subscribe. And y'all share this video, man.
We're
not
bringing back the boy Kylie Diggs no more.
Too bad.
Why she trying, y'all she trying to boycott you?
I've been boycotted since the first episode.
We're not going to tell you why we boycotted her, because we don't want to bring all that up. That's the past.
Because I'm great. There's a lot of haters out there.
And my cousin, Rodney Kelly, he said, good combo. Glad y'all are soaking in. All right. So, we're going to go with final thoughts, and since we have a first man to touch the dent, I want to say this real quick. Robert Morris was supposed to be here, and we are busy. Activism and working for our families and trying to get stuff done intersects with some of this stuff that we're trying to do, but we will get Robert Morris on one of these shows. But we thank Pastor Madison so much for coming through and giving us so much insight. Hey, it was short notice.
Like 20 minutes. Like
why are you telling all our videos?
I was in the backyard, like, what?
She was like, we got 6 minutes, you're gonna slide through. He was like,
your fresh too wrong. Okay, final thoughts. We're gonna let our guests have final thoughts.
Well, you know, I didn't know I was the first male to to bless the dance.
You're actually the second. It was a baby.
It's a baby. Okay, 8 months old. Okay, 6 months,
7 months. Shout out,
you
can tell
him.
He'll be one in June. Yeah.
Right, cool. That's cool. Well, I'm the first adult male to bless me. So thank you for the invitation for calling me. I appreciate it. And I look forward to hopefully coming again and having some more conversation. You know, final thoughts. I think one of the things that, you know, I think is really important, and I'm a married two comments you started with. The first is the whole church thing. You know, I think it's important that we not just have a faith that inspires us, but we should have a faith that forces us to be intellectuals about what we believe and what we think. And mm-hmm. so our thinking and our thinking have to go together. You know, so,
thinking and thinking.
So, you know, we got to make sure that we don't park our brains at our church doors. Two, mm-hmm. I think secondly, you know, I love the conversation. I love the passion. I love the issue that that we're confronting. The reality is we can never, ever fix what we won't face. And that's why you miss. but we have to go not to confront the issue, the face issue that plague our neighborhoods, our communities, our cities. And once we face them, once we confront them, then we know we can fix them. My last comment is this. I want to come back one day, and I want to discuss this whole thing of cussing versus cursing. Because I think, you know, we have misinterpreted what the Bible talking about when it says cursing. Mm-hmm. And so we have indoctrinated and made things religion that ain't gospel. So I'm laid out there for you, because I think we have allowed church to kind of prohibit our living. Anyway, go
ahead. That's my pastor.
I'm gonna go to his church, y'all.
And we're gonna discuss religion here one day. He has some really interesting approaches to religion. We're not gonna get into it today because we got a few minutes left.
But you found time.
Yeah, we only got a few minutes left. Mm-hmm. But that's my pastor.
This is the longest show ever. Ain't nobody gonna make me watch this.
Oh, we are. I do. I was just, hey, you laughing back there. Hey, hey, hey.
No, look, we were just talking about that. He said he's live 2 hours. I'm not watching it.
You got right. Final five. No, she do.
Well, you know, on a serious note, forget Sade.
Oh.
My boy, Kylie Lee.
No, on a serious note, forget Sade.
Just joking.
Didn't say that Sade, those beliefs do not reflect my feelings.
But for the last few shows, I've been trying to like wear shirts that kind of have a little bit to do.
I love how for that.
Subliminal messages for you guys to pay attention to when you close your eyes and you see my beautiful face, you know that it means something. No, but like we had a lot of different topics. We talked about molestation in the Black community. We talked about child support. Last week we talked about the Black man and the Black woman. We talked about things, our first show, because we're wretched.
They are wretched.
But no, we speak about a lot of different things, because I feel like the first thing that people think when they hear women and they get on the talk, we about to talk about men and sex. That's all we got to talk about. And it's such a broad spectrum of things that we all need to speak about. It's a lot of things that people need to hear because they're not going to read. And it's okay. I don't read, y'all. I have a real hard time with reading. Now my daughter's learning to read, so she reads to me. It's great. It works. But we need more shows. We need more people that are going to come out and say the different things that it is, because that's how some people learn. That's how some people are going to be able to get it. They're going to be able to see it from people who are actually how they get on my nerves.
That's
who
are
actually, you know what I'm saying? Like, living the lives, who are actually looking into the stuff, who are actually believing this, who've been on the front lines, who are behind the pulpit, we have so many feelings about pastors in the church, but there are really some great men behind those pulpit that we need to hear from, men and women. There are some powerful women reverends that people need to be able to hear from, and you don't have to be a Christian to listen to a Christian man speak. You know what I'm saying? I've heard some wonderful Muslim men speak. I've heard some Moorish Americans speak. And we have to be open to listen to all of that, because the more closed off we are, the less we will progress. This has been a great conversation. We talked a little bit about police brutality. I've dealt with it on several occasions. We've talked a little bit about the stuff in the history of Dallas, because so many of us think that we are good. We're not the St. Louis's, we not the, you know, the Phillies, we not the places, and yeah, Chicago's and New York's and stuff like that, and everything's gonna be okay, but stuff gets set out here a lot of times first, and then it gets hidden, and we don't talk about it. It doesn't make national news, it doesn't happen in different ways, and so no one knows, and we think that we are safe here. But if you don't understand about the sheep in the wolf in the sheep's clothing, you know what I'm saying? And you just keep thinking it's going to be that wolf that's going to come out and get you, you're going to get beat. So we have to start paying attention to a lot of different things. We have to open up our minds, and y'all keep tuning in, man, because we're going to keep coming with it.
Share this video right now if you love us. And if you didn't, then we're going to realize that you actually don't love us.
If you don't love us, you can share it still. Put a hating comment on it. We don't care. Just share it.
I'm of the blocking kind.
I'm not alone. I want you to see my growth.
I just want to say that to add on to something that she said, you know, that is one of the reasons why I'm not a Christian, but I love this pastor back here, Damian Madison, because he doesn't force anything on you. He gives you the truth, he dusts his feet, and he leaves your presence with something to chew on.
And I think that that's something that can be learned or something that can be taken from the ministry. Something that can be built upon from the ministry. Lily keeps something to say. She is, I said magical people, and I don't mean black magic or whatever. See, they wear black again. We're going to talk about this stuff. But anyway, she's only 24, yet she is so connected to who she is and what's going on in the world that she continues to amaze me. She had to check me the other day because I cut off all the time. It's because I be excited. I don't know. She got to check me back. But I just want to say, hey, thank you for tuning in. We love y'all. I love everybody here. We love each other. Sade, thank you for being in the comments. You a real trooper because I know you busy. Tuned in anyway. They don't like each other, but you better not mess with now one of them because the other one coming. You hear me?
I cannot be her friend, but you can't. That's how it works.
Well, what we gonna do is get on up out of here. This is the Den. We don't own the rights to any of this music. We want to thank our special guest, Pastor Damian Madison. Get it right. Put some respect on that. And
Tune in. That's just the way it is. Things will never be the same. That's just the way it is.
Oh yeah, I'm trying to do it.
That's just the way it is.
I would twerk for y'all, but the pastor here. Hey,
hey.
Oh, yeah.